So we better get started. The plan, I think, for today is to try and get through these three basic theorems about Banach spaces, which are this first one that we stated. The uniform boundedness principle. Says very briefly, if you have for all x the supremum over some index at alpha of the norms of t alpha x finite, so you get a t alphas and maps from some Banach space to some other Banach space, then in fact the supremum of the norms of those operators. Then after that, we've got the closed graph theorem and the open mapping theorem. But I guess let me not try and state those until we get. So let's quickly prove this. And the thing that we use was this corollary of the Bayer category theorem, which was that if a complete metric space. Countable union of closed sets. It's a countable increasing union. One of them, of those closed sets, has a non-empty interior. Okay, so with that corollary in hand, the uniform boundedness principle is pretty easy. So the trick is just, you define some sets that have something to do with this condition. So maybe a better way to think about it is we define some sets so that this condition tells us that these sets fill up all of X as we take the union. So we can just say here, these are all the X's. Such that the norm of T alpha applied to X is at most K for all X, for all alpha. Okay. So first of all, the hypothesis says that the whole space is just the union of these guys. Because for any particular x, we know that the supremum is finite, so there's some integer k, so that all of the t alpha x's are less than that k. So each point x is eventually in one of these sk's. Okay. Each sk is closed. As we can write it as. We can write Sk as the intersection of the alpha, because it's a condition that has to hold for all alpha, of, I guess we can write it as T alpha inverse, should write it like it's T alpha blank, and then take the norm. That's the whole function there, from the Banach space X to the real numbers. We apply T alpha and then we take the norm. Take that whole function inverse of the interval from 0 to k. Okay? Does that make sense what I'm doing there? This here is some function. Or before you take the inverse, this is some function from the Banach space X to the real numbers. So we can look at its inverse image. But of course this function is continuous. If T alpha is continuous, that's a continuous function from x to y, and then the norm by definition is a continuous function from y to the real numbers. So that's all continuous, that set's closed, so this is closed, and this is an arbitrary intersection of closed sets. So we get that. So some sk has a non-empty interior. In fact, we can do better than that. In fact, it's easy to see that SK is just the K times scaled up version of S1. Yeah? Just take all the points in S1 and multiply through by K. So in fact, we can just say that S1 has a non-empty interior. The category theorem only tells us that one of the SK has a non-empty interior, but because of that, in fact, all have a non-empty interior. And so we just get that, so there's X naught in S1, and some positive radius delta. So the ball around X naught of radius delta is sitting properly inside S1. Okay, so that means that if we have X in that ball, if we have X in the ball of radius delta around 0, then we can just use the triangle inequality. So we can compute, we can bound rather the norm of T alpha by the norm of T alpha of X naught plus the norm of T alpha applied to X minus X naught. And now, X naught is in this ball, so it's in S1. And X minus X naught is also in this ball, because X wasn't far away from 0, so X minus X naught isn't far away from X naught. So they're both inside the ball. So we can use the condition that defines S1 for both, yeah, and just say that that's less than 2. Yeah, but that's exactly boundedness. So equivalently, just because T alpha is linear for any X, the norm of T alpha X is less than or equal to 2 delta inverse. Okay? So then, times the have any x, you let y be x times delta divided by the norm of x. Oh. Put an extra factor of 2 in or something. Then that suddenly is in the ball, and then just unravel everything again. You have to get that. Okay. So this is telling you the norm of T alpha. Is it most 2 delta inverse, and this just didn't depend on alpha at all, so we got too much. Does that seem okay? Okay, so let's have a few neat corollaries of this. So if we have a sequence Tn bounded operators from one Banach space to another Banach space, and it converges pointwise, so that's just saying, i.e., Tn converges to Tx, some element Tx and Y, then the function that we're implicitly defining by T then is actually bounded. Okay, so if you have some bounded operators that converge pointwise, the limit's actually actually bounded. A great number of things in the subject of finite spaces is just a matter of working out how you're meant to apply the uniform boundedness principle in the right way. So the point is just that converging point-wise, implies point-wise bounded. For free vector x, you look at the sequence tnx, well, it's converging, so except for some initial segment which might do something crazy, after that initial segment, they're all really close to tx. And so you can calculate the supremum as the maximum over this initial bit, plus epsilon times the times whatever the norm of tx was. So point-wise convergence gives point-wise boundedness, and then the uniform boundedness principle says that the tn's are uniformly bounded. Okay, but it's easy to see here that whatever the norm of tx is, okay, that's less than the supremum of the norms of the tnx's. That's just the fact that the tnx's are converging to there. And then that's less than the supremum of the norms of the tn's times the norm of x. And of course, this is the supremum with respect to n. So after we do this, after we bound that norm by the product of those norms, this bit can just pop out of the supremum, okay? And we just prove boundedness of t, okay? Whatever that quantity was, it was the bound for t, okay? Okay, so there are some more examples in the notes of using the uniform boundedness principle to do surprising things, interesting things. There's a quite cute example that I think I might just not do in lecture at the moment, but it's worth having a look at, which shows that there are nice continuous functions on, say, the interval 0, 1, or 0 to 2 pi or something, but where when you compute their Fourier series actually diverges at some point, say at 0. Okay, so you've got a nice continuous function, certainly got a well-defined value at zero, but the Fourier series evaluated at zero is a divergent series. It's kind of gross, and a sad fact about Fourier series. Something that you'll find, however, is that if you remember the Bayer category theorem, use the axiom of choice implicitly in there to, if you stop and actually try and construct, write down a continuous function whose Fourier series diverges at some point, you will have great difficulty. And I don't think anyone knows how to actually explicitly write one down, because the axiom of choice is making it a non-constructive item. Okay, so fine. If you want to look at that, it's in the notes. It's kind of cute. And again, it's just an application of the uniform boundedness principle. Okay, so let's get on to the closed graph theorem. So here, if A is a subset of some space X, F is a map from A to Y, we say the graph of F. So here, the point that I want to think about is I'm thinking here of f as being just some partially defined function on x. So it's some I'm thinking of it's like a function on x, but it's not defined everywhere. That's why I've introduced this a. And so then the graph of f is just all of the points x, f of x, where x is in a. And I'm thinking of this as a subset of x cross y. Okay. So then so what can we see? So But certainly, if f is defined everywhere, and f is continuous, then I think a pretty elementary fact is that the graph of f is closed in x cross y. Okay? And so the point of this theorem is now that we're looking for converses. So a way of saying that if you take the graph of f and you happen to know it's closed, then the function that it was the graph of must have been a continuous function. Okay. So before we prove that that happens when x and y are Banach spaces, let's just observe that you do have to be a little bit careful. If f is not defined everywhere, the converse might not hold. And so the nice example here is so here, if we let x be the continuous functions on 0, 1, which also have continuous derivatives, and then we just let y be the continuous functions on 0, 1, and we can define d from, actually, sorry, let me try and keep the nomenclature the same. Let's write A for the continuously differentiable guys. And really, and what I'm thinking here is that we've actually got X and Y both being the set of all continuous functions. And A obviously here is some subset of X. It's the continuous functions that also have continuous derivatives. Okay. So we define the derivative just by sending F to its derivative. Great. And so, the first claim is that the graph of D is closed. So what does it mean to say that the graph of a function is closed? Well, that's saying if fn converges, oh, and let's say and here, these are all just with the supremum. So saying the graph of D is closed is saying that if you have a bunch of functions in A, and the derivatives are converging to some G, and then that's just allowed to happen in Y, then F prime equals G. Okay, so here we're imagining, so this pair, Fn comma Fn prime, is some sequence of points in the graph. Okay, we're just saying if that sequence of points converges, remember, so if some sequence of points in the graph is converging, then we better have that point that it's converging to is actually on the graph. Okay. And that's true. That's hopefully something that you feel like you could do from analysis 1 or 2 or something. Okay. So I'm not gonna prove that. But easily now, D is not bounded. Okay. You can have functions whose supremum norm is 1, say, but the supremum norm of the derivative is as large as you like, because you just make very, very wiggly functions that are about, even just like the sine and x functions. Show you that D is not bounded. Okay, so So, what can we do? Well, so I guess let's make a definition first. Yeah, so so if x and y are norm spaces, A is subspace of X. In a linear map, F from A to Y is called closed if the graph of A is closed in X cross Y. Okay, so this, it's a little bit confusing here because this condition is about closeness in X cross Y, which might be a different condition than whether you're asking whether it's closed in A cross Y. I mean, you can talk about the graph of F forgetting about X and just thinking about the subspace of the function as actually defined. Or you could think about it. Okay. So another way of saying that is that Xn converges to X. Txn converges to y, then x is actually still in A. Okay, so this, so maybe I should see it for some x in x, and here for some y in y. Then actually the x was in the subspace A, and in T of x equals 1. Okay? Okay, and now the theorem is just that if T from X to Y, a linear map between Banach spaces, is closed. And here, since we haven't mentioned A, you should be thinking sort of A equals X. We're talking about a function that's defined on, that's defined everywhere. Then T is continuous. Okay. So before maybe just before we prove it, let's try and explain why this is so awesome. It seems like a bit of a, maybe it doesn't. It doesn't at first seem awesome, but the point is that checking something is closed is much cheaper than checking that it's continuous. Okay, so to check something is continuous, what would we have to do? We'd have to show that if we know that Xn converges to X, we would have to show that Txn was a convergent sequence in the first place. That's what we'd have to do to show continuity. But to show closeness, we have to do much less. We're allowed to say, well, if Xn converges to X, and we're allowed to assume that the Txn's are converging somewhere, all that we've got to do, in this setting, there's nothing to check here, A was the whole space, all we've got to do is check that T of that limit point is that limit point. And that's much cheaper than showing that a Y existed in the first place. Okay? So that's why the theorem is good. Okay. So before we prove the theorem, we need a little lemma, which is kind of neat. So X, a Banach space, and lambda, some real number greater than 1. So here, suppose we've got A a subset of X, just a subset. So if the norm of X is at most 1, there exists Y in the subset, so that Y is at most 1 over lambda away from X. Okay, so this is like a really weak version of density. It's saying we're only interested in approximating stuff in the unit ball, and we're not even saying you can get arbitrarily close, we're just saying you can get within 1 over lambda.
Okay.
Then, again for x in the unit ball, there exists a sequence, yn, all in this set A. So you can write x as this sort of geometric series. Well, it's not, I guess it's not a geometric series, but it's this series where you're summing up the yn's with smaller and smaller weights depending on lambda. Okay. Let's see if we can. Proof in the corner of the board. Well, what do you do? So you just apply the hypothesis. To obtain y naught. Okay? Just some y naught that's within lambda inverse of the x we started with. Okay, and then the point is that we can now say that if you look at lambda times x minus y naught, well, the point is that's less than 1. Okay, so we can we applied the hypothesis with our with the x that we started with, but now we can apply the hypothesis with lambda times x minus y naught. So there is y1 with that's close to this guy. Okay? And then you just sort of keep going. That's sort of the inductive step. But I really can't fit it in that little space there. That was a bad idea, sorry. So inductively, suppose we've got y0 up to yn all in A already chosen, so that x minus this sum, I should have used a different index there, m, n equals 0 up to m, yn is less than, how small do we need to make it? We need to make it lambda to the minus n minus 1. Okay? The point is that then you can just multiply it through. You can write lambda to the n plus 1 x plus, sorry, getting my indices horribly confused, m minus 1, m plus 1. That less than 1, and so then we choose a new we choose a next ym plus 1 so that now with m 1 greater we get that. Sorry, I'm explaining this really poorly, but do people see what's going on? Should I? What do you think? So at the beginning, we've certainly got this with if I take m equals minus 1, okay, that's the base case of this induction. M equals minus 1 says, well, we've got just an empty list of y's, okay, and an empty sum here, and we put m equals minus 1, this becomes lambda to the 0, okay? So we've got the base case, because this base case just says the norm of x is at most 1. Great. That was our hypothesis. We're working with some x that had norm at most 1. So let's say now that we've chosen some y0 through yn so that this happens. Okay? Well, multiplying through by lambda to the n plus 1 to clear the right-hand side, so here it is multiplied by lambda to the n plus 1 everywhere, that's less than 1. So now the point is that for any x, maybe I should have used different letters, x in here and here. Maybe it would have been clearer if I'd said, if we put a z there, and a z there. Because as we're trying to prove this conclusion for x, we're using this this first hypothesis many times with different values of z each time. The first time we use it happens to be for x, but it changes. So now we do it with that whole thing there being this z. So we choose a next y n plus 1. So lambda n plus 1 x plus all this junk. Minus y. I really want to I changed a plus to a minus there, which is why I get confused. Minus y m plus 1 is less than lambda inverse. And now I can just divide back through by lambda m plus 1. And I get exactly this statement, but with m increased by 1. Okay? And so that means that inductively you can construct this infinite sequence, and the fact that these differences are going like lambda to the minus m means that actually that infinite, if we make this infinite sequence there, it really is converging to x. Okay. Okay, so that was the lemma. Graph theorem, which is still on the board over there. Good. Okay. But sort of the same idea in the sense that we're going to use the uniform boundedness theorem, sorry, not the uniform boundedness theorem, the corollary of the bare category theorem to get something good. So if we let AK be the set of all x's in x, so that the norm of T of x is less than or equal to k, then of course, completely trivially, x is the union of all of the AKs. Just because for any given x, the norm of T of x is some number, so actually k is bigger than that. And easily the AKs are closed, but the same sort of argument before, this is a continuous function, so that that condition is a closed condition in x. So some AK has non-empty interior, i.e. it contains some ball of some radius sitting inside of it. Now it's a bit of a pain in this argument. No one caught me say flagrantly incorrect things. Here I just said that the AK are closed because this is a sort of closed condition on x. What is it that we're trying to prove today in this theorem? What's the goal?
That it's closed.
No. The hypothesis is that T is closed, and the conclusion is that T is continuous. We're trying to prove that T is continuous. So at this point, we don't know T is continuous. So we don't know at all that this is a closed condition. Oops. Okay, the AKs are definitely not closed. But that's still true. And that in particular tells you also that x is the union of the closures of the AKs, And so some AK closure has non-empty interior, but at the moment we've got no idea whether the AKs have actually closed or not. So we have to worry about that. Okay. And in fact, I think it may, life gets a little bit easier a bit later if we make this the closed unit ball as well. So obviously if you can fit an open unit ball inside, if you can fit an open ball, you can fit in a slightly smaller closed ball. Okay, now, if x is in AK, easily enough, minus x is in AK as well. Yeah, doesn't care up there. And so the ball around minus x naught, also of radius delta, is also in here. So now we do the following trick. So if x is in the ball of radius around zero of radius delta, we can write x as x naught plus x minus x naught. Okay, and this guy is in that closed ball of radius delta around x, and this is in the ball around minus x naught delta, just because x is small. Okay. So x can be approximated. So let's see. Since x is in that closed ball, and the closed ball is in this closure, that means we can find a point in AK arbitrarily close to x naught. And we can find another point in AK arbitrarily close to x minus x naught. So we can find, it can be approximated by the sum of two elements in A sub K. Okay, one to approximate x naught, one to approximate this guy. And the point is that that sum is in A sub 2K. Okay? This is just sort of saying if you've got two different things in A sub K, the sum by the triangle inequality is in A sub 2K. So what did we just get? We just proved that the closure of the ball around zero is contained in the closure of A sub 2K. Okay? So this bit here was sort of dealing with this annoying technical problem that having non-empty interior just gave us some closed ball sitting far off in space, and it was really the closed ball around zero that we wanted to get, so we had to do this little bit of fiddling to get around that. And then, if we just, what do we need to do? So if we pick M at least 2K delta inverse, then just by scaling up, obviously here, actually I should have maybe done this trick at first, right at the beginning, like just like in the other proof we did, if one of them has non-empty interior, all of them have non-empty interior, because these sets are all just scaled versions of each other. It would have been nicer if I'd done things more consistently, but we can get that this is in the closure of some, the actual unit ball is contained in the closure of one of the AMs. Okay. So, what was the point of that? We can now apply the lemma. We'll apply the lemma with somehow it's a little bit strange here, I think, that we're just using the lemma. Is that the lemma was about sort of a subset A that it wasn't even dense in the unit ball, it was only, you could only approximate within lambda inverse. Okay? And here we've actually at this stage proved something much stronger. We've actually proved that AM is actually dense in the unit ball, but still we're going to forget that it's actually dense and only use the fact that it's sort of, you can approximate within some fixed amount to get the rest of the way. So any case, so apply the lemma with the subset A being AM, and you just take lambda to be anything, and 2 is nice and convenient, okay? And so what that tells you is for any x, norm at most 1, there exists a sequence, yms, in am, so that x is actually the sum of 2 to the negative m, ym. Okay, so what do we get from that? Well, we now want to try and compute what, so we want to show that T of X equals this, which we, I mean, is not obvious because at this point we don't know T is continuous. But if we can do that, then it's, then life is pretty good, because then you can compute the norm of T, and the point is it's at most. Norm TYM, but of course the YMs are in A big M, which says that all those numbers are at most K, at most big M rather, so it's less than or equal to sum M equals infinity to the minus little m times big M, which is of course just 2 times M. Okay, so if we can just show this fact, then we'll have got boundedness of T. Okay.
Scott.
Yeah.
When you say there exists YM in AM.
Yes.
So does that mean that, so up the second line, you say there exists YM in AM. So are you saying like Y1 is in AM?
Oh, no, yeah, sorry. My bad font and bad choice of letters here. That's a capital M, and these are lowercase m's here. So there's some fixed big capital M that we fixed a moment ago here, as long as it was bigger than 2k times delta inverse. And then we, then applying the lemma to that particular A capital M, we got a sequence of Y lowercase m's, all in that same fixed AM.
Yeah.
Okay. So to show this, we look at the norm of sort of a little partial sum of this. We sum from R equals, I've chosen letters so badly. Okay, so let's keep the index M. Let's go from S up to T. T's already used. I'm trying to do better at avoiding letters. Let's go from P to Q. Okay, of this quantity. Y. Okay, and this is just a finite sum, yeah. So, so that's bounded by. You can sort of move the T inside the sum, and then apply that we know what the norms of the TYMs are. Okay, and. The point is now that this is going to zero as p is going to infinity. Okay, So the point is that what's the point? But these partial sums, if you look at t of the sum from zero, from n equals zero up to q, form a Cauchy sequence, okay? Because the differences are small, so we just proved that that this really is a convergent sequence. So notice at this point we haven't actually done anything, in the sense that we haven't even used the hypothesis that T was closed. So we can't possibly have proved anything at this point, but we just proved that sum from m equals 0 to infinity, T to the minus m, T y m, is a convergent series. But we don't know what it converges to. In particular, we don't know it converges to Tx. Okay, and so here's finally where you hit everything with a hammer. But the point is that T is closed. Okay? And that's exactly saying that since x is this sum, and this sum is converging to something, the thing it's got to converge to is exactly T of x. Okay? So T of x. The limit as n goes to infinity, t applied to n equals 0 to q, 2 to the minus m, ym, which we just showed was converged. Okay, and then that argument. This argument here computes the bound for t. Okay. We don't have time to prove the open mapping theorem, I guess, today, but it's only a few lines. So let me give the one line proof of something that was quite mysterious before. Do you remember when we were talking about the spectrum? The point is that the spectrum of an operator was those numbers lambda, so that t minus lambda I did not have a bounded inverse. And I mentioned at the time that it didn't matter whether we asked for the inverse to be bounded or not. And so here's the ridiculous bounded inverse theorem. T maps x to y, is continuous between two Banach spaces, and as a linear map, an inverse. Okay? And the conclusion is that inverse is just automatically bounded. Okay? They're bounded linear maps between Banach spaces with inverses. Necessarily, that inverse is bounded. And the proof is just completely ridiculous. Okay? So the point is that T is continuous, so T is closed, which tells you that the graph of T is closed in x cross y. But that's just the same statement as saying that the graph of T inverse is closed in y cross x, because being the inverse function just means your graph is like the thing you get by flipping over the diagonal, okay? And now the closed graph theorem tells us that T inverse is bounded as a function from y to x, okay? Completely ridiculous. Okay, we better stop there. So we still have the open mapping theorem to do, and then that'll take only a moment. And then the next big thing is the Hahn-Banach theorem, which basically tells you how to take linear functionals that are only defined on a subspace and guarantees that you can always extend them up to linear functionals defined on the whole space. Yep.
With that limit that you're trying to send n to infinity, should that be not an n or something more?
This one here?
No, the bottom, very bottom one. Should that be a q or something?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, that should be a q.